So students, today we are going to start with that of the constitution. It would be the part 3 of chapter 1. Again, I would like to tell you that chapter 1 will take little bit long. Reason is this chapter 2 rights has been merged with that of this chapter, the constitution, why and how. So this chapter can take little bit long, but please no need to be worried for that. We'll cover it up. It's weightage is also maximum. So we come back on a topic. We had left the topic on the last function of the constitution, or why do we need the constitution. This was fundamental identity. We were talking on this fundamental identity of people. Okay. In this, we had discussed that this topic would be covered up under the three heads. Point A, it was the political identity. We had discussed political identity.
Moral identity.
Very good. Second was point B. This was moral identity.
And shared beliefs.
And shared beliefs. Very good.
Yes.
Or we could say sometimes national identity.
Okay.
Moral.
Okay.
We'll just discuss all these three in brief. Okay. I hope all of you have already read it out. Moral identity and shared beliefs, we could say. Shared beliefs or national identity. Got it? Now, first of all, political identity. Yes, anyone would like to speak something, please? Anyone would like to explain? Speak up fast, what? Peter. Yes, political identity. Yes. Yes, political identity.
Ma'am, political identity means all the people were agreed to some basic norms and principles.
Yes.
And provide them a basic political identity.
Yes, obviously. Basically, political identity is the people living inside the political boundary of the country, within the domestic territory of the country, which is known as the political boundary also. The people who are living inside that boundary, all of them enjoy the rights as a citizen of that particular country. Getting it? So it means they agree to certain basic norms and principles of the constitution. Okay, so in such a manner, constitution provides a political identity to the people. Secondly, moral identity. In the moral identity, what happens if we speak in terms of the constitution of India, all of us could see, apart from the fundamental rights, apart from the provisions for the fundamental rights, we could see the provisions for the directive principles of state policy. We could see the provisions for the fundamental duties of the people. Okay, some certain duties have also been provisioned in the Constitution of India, which are expected to be followed, to be fulfilled by every citizen of the country or by every people of the country. So this is known as the moral identity. What they should do and what they should not do. What is expected as morals? What are the moral duties of the citizens of the country? Getting it? So this is known as the moral identity. Third identity is the shared beliefs of the national identity. National identity means the sense of collective belongingness. We have the shared beliefs. Okay, this is known as the national identity. Children, please mute yourself, everyone. If anyone wants to speak, only in that condition you will unmute yourself. Please. Okay. So national identity means the sense of collective belongingness. Okay, that we belong to one country. We belong to India. We are Indians. We are the Indian first. Okay. Then later anything else. Okay. So this is known as the national identity. After this, we come on the next. We had already discussed all these. And now we come on the next topic, the authority of the Constitution. I'm going to clear this. Okay. Now we come on next, the authority of the Constitution. What do we mean by the authority of the Constitution? Why everyone is bound by the Constitution of any country? Why the people will follow the Constitution? Okay. So what's the authority of the Constitution? To find out the authority of the Constitution, we'll have to find out the answer to some questions. These are, number one, we'll have to find out what is a constitution. We have already been
what is a constitution?
Yes. What is a constitution? Secondly, we'll have to find out. What is a constitution? Secondly, we'll have to find out how effective it is. How can we say that the constitution is quite effective in the country? How effective it is? How can we say this? Third question, we'll have to find out the answer. This is a constitution just or not? Is a constitution just or not? So to find out the authority of the Constitution, how far the constitution of any country is authorized, to find out the answer of this question, to discuss this topic, we'll have to find out the answer to some questions. These are, number one, first of all, we'll have to see what is a constitution. We have already discussed, obviously, this is the set of some basic principles, okay, which are supposed to be followed by every citizen of the country, and how effective it is. Secondly, how far is the constitution of India effective, or is the constitution just or not? I hope answer to the first question is very clear to you all. Need not to discuss it again. Yes? And
yes, ma'am.
Now we come, yes, on the ma'am. Second. How, yes, effective ma'am. It is. How can we say that the constitution of India is effective? Yes? Okay. Just let me know one thing. Is the constitution of India effective or not? Yes or no?
Ma'am, yes.
Yes. How can you say that this is effective?
Yes.
How can
ma'am,
you
yes,
say?
It's effective.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Can I speak?
It's, yes, of course. Speak a bit.
They do not. Yes, ma'am. They do not give enormous power to anyone. Like, ma'am, if someone has the upper post, then they are not able to misuse their power because it is not mentioned in the constitution that government cannot take actions without the suggestion of the others or the people.
Ma'am, can I answer?
Yes, please. Yes, beta, please. Speak up.
Ma'am, Indian Constitution was formed by Constituent Assembly and prepared by popular leaders. In some countries, Constitution doesn't work properly because the Constitution is made by the military chiefs, dictator, or the autocracy. But the country like India, Constitution is effective because there is a long period of freedom movement. Also, the power is equally distributed among the institution. The failure or success of any constitution is depend on its institutional designs. And in India, the power is equally distributed among the legislature, executive, and judiciary. And it ensures that if an institution misuses its power, other can prevent it.
Okay, just let me know one thing. How far the effectiveness by all these points concerned? How can you say that this is effective? People can deny. People can deny to follow all these. So how can you say no? Our constitution is quite effective. It's not casual. Okay, everyone is bound by the constitution.
Ma'am, because it is totally dependent on people's choice.
Because this is totally
depend on people's choice.
Depend on people's choice. No constitution. Kaise, how can you say that it depends on the people's choice? Yes.
Ma'am, because एक rules and regulations होता है जिसके basis पे ही हम लोग मतलब government हमारे लिए decisions लेती है वो भी हमारे बताने पे.
So government, I'm just saying my point is, please try to get the point. I'm just saying government can deny. So what is the effectiveness?
Ma'am, can I speak?
Yes, please.
We cannot say the Indian constitution is properly effective, but it works properly in if we compare it from other constitutions. As we can see, the Pakistan's constitution, it is a constitution, but actually it's just a written constitution and it is not followed by them properly. But in our country, the constitution is followed, the rules written in the constitution are followed by the people as well as the government. And we all have rights, but we also have some duties. And with duties, we are bounded that we would have to follow these rules. If the government exploits our rights and rules, then the government would be punished and people have the authority to change the government. And if the people, the citizen of the country are not obeying the rules or they are misusing their powers, their rights, then the government can punish them for that. So it is an interlinked connection that if someone is not following the rules and like just one is exploiting the rights of others, then through the constitution, through the guidelines of constitution, one shall be punished by the other. So this all this system, and my friend Neil mentioned there that we have a system of legislative, executives and judiciary. It's like a horizontal, and there are horizontal and vertical distributions of power, which ensures that there is no misuse of power. So all these things, when combined with each other, makes our constitution effective, because the practice of this constitution, our Indian constitution, is good.
Listen, good. Everyone participated in the discussion. Very good. Okay. But one thing, please keep remember, the constitution of India is very much effective. You can't say that this is not effective. Now, what are the reasons behind it? Number one, first of all, basically, if we speak of this, how effective the constitution of India is, will have to go through many, many factors. Like number one, first of all, we'll have to go through the mode of promulgation of the Constitution of India. The effectiveness of the Constitution, first of all, whatsoever the factor plays an important role. It always depends on the making of the Constitution or mode of promulgation of the Constitution. How has the Constitution been promoted? How do we promote a Constitution? Okay. So the Constitution of India has always been very much effective. Please keep remember, you can never say that the Constitution of India is not effective. Why? Now we'll discuss the different factors. First of all, to see the effectiveness of the Constitution. First of all, we'll discuss the mode of promulgation. Secondly, we'll see what are the provisions which are substantive. Substantive means what kind of provisions have been made by the Constitution, have been included in the Constitution, which have an acceptability among the people. It means that every citizen of the country accepts all those provisions. No one counters them. Because those are based on the just considerations. No discrimination had been there. Okay, all these things we'll discuss now to see the effectiveness of the Constitution. Getting my point? First of all, number one, our Constitution, first of all, we could say, our Constitution is a written document. This is written. It's not on the basis of evolution, in fact. If we speak in terms of the other countries, if we take the example of United Kingdom, if we take the example of Russia even, okay, many times they have changed the basic structure of their Constitution. They needed it. Reason? Their constitution is based on the evolution. Okay? But the Constitution of India is a written document. So this is very much effective. Reason? Every provision has been written down, and every person is bound by the Constitution. So it depends. The mode of promulgation of the Constitution of our country made it effective. Now we'll see. First of all, we'll discuss the mode of promulgation. Then you will see the effectiveness of our Constitution. Secondly, in the preamble, all of you could see the Constitution of our country. It starts with the language, "We the people of India." Getting it? It's not written in that "you the people of India." It's written "we the people of India." It means government is also included there. It does not use "you the people of India" or the people of India. "We the people of India," it means it includes the government also over there. Okay. So this is number one. This is the written document, and to see the effectiveness, now we'll discuss first of all the mode of promulgation. Second factor which makes it effective, this is the mode of promulgation. Mode of promulgation. So all of you, just let me know what was the mode of promulgation of the Constitution of India. Anyone can explain, please? Anyone can speak up something on this point? Yes, ma'am. Yes, please.
Mode of promulgation.
The Constitution was created after the popular national movement.
Yes, very good. mode of promulgation means, listen, if the mode of promulgation, if we had been promoted our constitution under the pressure of military, if the military dictators had been promulgated it, at that time the provisions might have the little different, okay, but we have promulgated our constitution to the national movement. How did we promulgate this under the national movement? Because many popular leaders who participated in the national movement, all of them were the members of the Constituent Assembly who made the Constitution of India the Constituent Assembly. And who were the members of the Constituent Assembly? Maximum members had been popular there who leaders. Had yes who had Indian already National participated Congress. In the national movement of the country. Someone was raising the hand. Yes, please. Who wanted to speak? Someone raised the hand. Yes, please, you can speak. Okay. So first of all, mode of promulgation, in this we can write down the points. Point A, please note down its points. You will have to explain in the notes. Number one, national movement. You could say national movement. National movement means the many popular leaders who participated in the national movement, they were the members of the Constituent Assembly. Okay. Secondly, can you give me some examples which constitutions have been made under the national movement?
Constitution of South Africa.
Very good. Very good. Constitution of South Africa. Yes, and Constitution of India. Yes, USA. Yes, very good. Okay. So these countries, the mode of promulgation is the national movement. Many popular leaders participated in the Constituent Assembly, and then the constitution of the country was drafted. Okay. Yeah. And this Constituent Assembly, second, will write point B. This is the Constitution of India is not based on the evolution. This is not based on any kind of declaration. This is based. It was framed by the Constituent Assembly. Constituent Assembly. It was framed by the Constituent Assembly. And this Constituent Assembly was created. Matlab it took the time between, I would like to mention it here, perhaps in December. In December, in short, I'm writing this DEC. In December 1946, to November, in short, I'm writing 26. This annual.
26th November 1949.
Yes, 26th November 1949.
Nine.
This is 1949. Okay, so Constituent Assembly was created between this period from December 1946 to November 1949, and it drew upon a long history of the nationalist movement. And it had the remarkable ability to take along different sections of the Indian society together. Okay. What happens? Third point we can write in the mode of promulgation. In the Constituent Assembly, this Constituent Assembly had the members of the Constituent Assembly were from every section of the society. No section was left from participating in the Constituent Assembly. Actually, we could say the members of the constituent assembly were elected, but by indirect method. We'll discuss it later. Then we'll discuss the making of the constitution. Then we'll discuss about all these. Okay, but at the moment, you have to keep remember to write down the point under the mode of promulgation that we had every member. We have the members from every section of the society, from the different languages, from the different communities, from the different cultures. Okay, we had the members from the different religions. So every section of the society participated in the promulgation of the constitution, because they were the member of the constituent assembly. So the third point we can write, every section of the society represented in the constituent assembly. Got it? So the constitution drew enormous legitimacy from the fact that it was drawn up by the people who enjoyed immense public credibility, who had the capacity to negotiate and command the respect of a wide cross section of the society. These people were able to convince the people that the constitution was not an instrument only to enjoy the personal powers. Okay, because the final document reflected the broad national consensus at that time. Point D, we could write down here, broad national consensus. Broad national consensus. What do we mean by this? Broad national consensus. It means Constituent Assembly had decided that we want to make any provision on the basis of referendum, on the basis of voting. No provision will be included in the constitution on the basis of voting only. So then what would be the method? They decided that we may have the differences from each other at some times, at some provisions, but we would like to discuss it mutually, rather than having a voting on this, rather than having a referendum on this. So the decisions would be taken on the basis of consensus only. Okay, now all of you just decide. If all these had been the features at the time of promulgation of the constitution, is this possible that the constitution of the country would not be effective? Yes. So it would be effective or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Effective.
It would be effective. So mode of promulgation of the constitution for any country always play an important role to make the constitution effective for the country. Have you got it? Yes, have you got it?
Yes.
So now yes, we come
yes,
on the
yes ma'am.
Yes. Next we'll see what makes effective. It would be the third one. First, we have seen the written document, second, mode of promulgation, and third, we'll discuss under substantive provisions. Third, it will also be explained under the point how effective it is. How can we say that the Constitution of India is effective? Substantive provisions. Provisions of the constitution. So please all of you just tell me what are the substantive provisions which are acceptable to each and everyone. In very short, we would like to clear this. Because the Constitution of India has the provisions for equality. It has worked on
freedom or equality.
Freedom. And freedom of the people. It means no discrimination, no discriminatory policies have been adopted by the Constitution of India. We do not discriminate with any people of the country. Constitution grants the equal rights to each and everyone, to each and every people of the country. If Constitution has granted the freedom, so it does not mention that a particular group of the country can enjoy the certain freedoms and the others cannot. So no discriminatory policies are there. Like now we could see that we have made the provisions for untouchability also under the rights against exploitation, and untouchability has also been declared as a punishable offense now. So we have the provisions for that also. The Constitution of India has provided the protection to the fundamental rights also under the fundamental right to constitutional remedies. Okay, so all these are the substantive provisions. Substantive provisions means which are acceptable to each and everyone, that every citizen and every people of the country accepts them. So the Constitution of India has the substantive provisions. Number four, how effective this is? What does make the Constitution effective? It depends on. Next is
balanced institutional design.
Very good. Balanced institutional design. How can you say, all of you have studied all these horizontal power distribution, vertical yes, power ma'am. Distribution,
legislative
all these in power institution. Sharing. So balanced yes. institutional
design
has been adopted by the Constitution of India. Okay. So next we'll discuss this, and after that we'll discuss how was the Indian Constitution made. Please don't miss the class. Then next we'll discuss composition of the Constituent Assembly, the principle of deliberation. All these things we'll discuss in the next class. Okay, child?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, beta. God bless you.
Okay, ma'am.